the radio session, and Pooman will continue.
Okay.
Concentrating on the
yes. Well, it's actually it's little bit of that and little bit of not that, but I wanted to start with this slide because some people asked me good references for radio interferometry, and I think if you have these two books, I think, and you have read much of it, you know it all. So these are the two references. And now let's come to the high frequency module. It's actually not a high frequency module, it involves everything. Okay, in the last module what we did, we understood little bit of radio interferometry, we created some images, we try to fiddle with the images, and finally we estimated the flux densities, right? Now at the end of the day, that is the most important thing, that is your purpose, to estimate the flux density. And since in this workshop, this is growth workshop where we concentrate lot on transients, in this I am going to start with that we have flux densities at various radio frequencies and at various epochs, and what can we do with that. And I would really like to thank David Kaplan for creating this module. I have zero contribution in creating this module, so it's all thanks to him. I'm only just talking a little bit about it. So now we can try to, at the end of the day, for everything we do at the end of the day, to extract the science out of it, and to understand that in this module we have picked a event, or you can event of the decade if you may call that. It's a gravitation wave event, which was the two neutron star merger. And this gravitational wave event was the first event where we not only saw the gravitational wave but also the photons, electromagnetic counterpart of it. And this was all synchrotron emission, which means if you have the data, radio data, well sampled in frequency and time, you can get lot of information. And this so that's where we are going to concentrate. What can we do with this? One thing is, again, as I showed you, I was talking about this non-thermal emission in the last module. Non-thermal emission was synchrotron, if you remember. This is exactly that kind of event where two neutron stars merge together, and then there is a, you know, this relativistic ejector interacting with the medium is creating the synchrotron emission. So the property of synchrotron emission is that this is the time axis, this is the frequency. At earlier and earlier time, synchrotron is stronger, but it is peaking at higher and higher high frequencies as you go in the time, and the peak moves to lower and lower frequencies, and synchrotron peak, and it also becomes weaker with time. And while this is a bad news for optical astronomers or X-ray astronomers, because this peak is the optical and X-ray emission is gone way too soon, in radio emission it stays for much longer time, and that gives us opportunity to study these things for a very long time, and that has lot of important it's a lot of significance to it. One thing is that at the early time, these things are all relativistic effects, so they have Lorentz beaming and lot of things to disentangle with to understand the energetics of the system. Later and later, the emission, it starts to become, as the Lorentz factor goes down with time, the emission starts to become quasi spherical, energetics are much more in control, and also as it's peaking at lower and lower frequencies with time, you have information about the density of the medium, because synchrotron is being produced by the interaction of this relativistic ejector from this explosion into the surrounding medium. And since the synchrotron, how the emission will look, whether it is optically thin, optically thick, they all have some significance on the density. So these are the information we get, and so this is this event, as I said, gravitational wave event 1708-17. It has, so this module has the data which has already been published in at least 3 papers or more, and the data was taken by most of the major telescopes all over the world, VLA, ATCA, GMRT, and even later on we added the Meerkat data to this. So there are a lot of data, and we are doing the flux density measurements, and the units in the flux density are, I've been talking about Jansky a lot, but if you convert into CGS, is 10 to the power minus 26 ergs per second per centimeter per hertz. You can imagine how weak the radio signals are, you know. So this is what we will be doing, and so let's start the module and start to look at the data. So I want you to load the data, and in fact I want you to print the data and show me how the data looks, and can you see the data, and what are the different columns in the data. You would see that it has delta t, which is time since explosion. So we are assuming that the moment it exploded, it was t is equal to 0, and then how many days since that explosion. The second column is the telescope. There are various telescopes which are hidden somewhere here. These are the frequencies in gigahertz, and these are the flux densities in microjansky. Microjansky will be then 10 to the power minus 29, minus 29 in CGS, and then this is the RMS. Okay, so this is the data, and then we need to plot this data because we need to see how the data looks with time and with frequency. So in the, so the exercise is mentioned right here. You need to complete this code. You have to color code the different telescope. You have to read, there are these 3 telescopes. Okay, so some part is done for you. Just color code the data with different telescopes, and also color coding with frequency, and plot the data, and just finish the code and plot the data. And we are going to plot in the log scale. Done. Does it look like something like this? Okay, I think let's look at this plot along with this data for a while, because we need to understand how to look at the data. Okay. So these two things, if you concentrate flux and RMS, do you think, what do you think, whether this data is more reliable or this data is more reliable? Which measurement is more reliable between the two, just to pick at random? And this and this, and which is the least reliable measurement and which is the most reliable measurement, and why? No? This on 216 days, this and this. Anyone? 55 is what? Most reliable. And which one is the least reliable? Why? What ratio? See, that's the thing, when you get the data, you have lot of detections, okay. Some may be more reliable, some may be less reliable, okay. And we assume that this error, RMS includes all kinds of error which are possible, right. Which means that this data could have been either 43 at most or 29, right? Within 29 and 43, like, you know, if this is one sigma error, right? So this is at only a 3 sigma detection, little over 3 sigma, whereas this is close to 5 sigma detection, around 4.5 something. This is 4 sigma detection, right? So when you, and these things are real, so when you are fitting the data, now you can see here also, now in these observations, you will probably rely this data more than that data, because this has much small error bar, right? So your significance of the data is in measured in some sense the error and how many sigma detection you have. And when you fit the data to do your science, because you are going to get sometimes spurious data, which data to believe more, which data to believe less. Okay, so that's what this tells you. Okay. These diamond, square, circle, they tell you different telescope, the color tell you the frequency, and these are the errors in the data. This data seems very good, right? This data seems good. This data has large error bar. This data has large error bar, right? But even between this and this, that may be more reliable, because this is closer to 3 sigma. That is, this the ratio is much higher. So that's how we decide the how good the data is. And now this, what have I shown? Light curve. Okay, so can we pick this plot and start doing the light curve analysis? If yes, why not? Different frequencies, right? Because they are all, these data are all different frequency, which means if you want to do light curve analysis, either you pick only one frequency, okay, and this is perfectly fine, and this is how maybe one should do it, assuming you have lot of such data at one frequency. But what if you do not have too much data at one frequency, you have only few data at one frequency, and which is not possible for you to carry out fits. So what do? You have to scale the data, okay. So scale the data. So what do you have to do? You have to find the spectral index of the data. What do you mean by spectral index? Is that given a time, at that particular time instant, you observed at two frequencies, and how this changed, the flux changed between two frequencies, or in some sense, you know, your flux is proportional to how this thing is changing. Now if it, and this is not a very set in stone method, because this method, if you find out this thing, the spectral index, then you know how the fluxes are changing with the frequency, and you can scale the whole all data set to one frequency, one your favorite frequency, whichever you want, and then you carry on your analysis of your light curve. But is that so easy? No, because that has few assumptions. One assumption is that all the data is following one spectral index. Okay, what does that mean is you are assuming the whole data is following this spectral index. In an ideal world, it is correct. In an ideal world, what happens? Electrons are accelerated, and we are assuming, generally we assume that the acceleration is because of the diffusive Fermi acceleration. So the energy index of electron is something like this. Where gamma is 2 alpha plus 1, and then this alpha goes here. Okay. This is the general assumption. And then if life is like this, everything is good, and you can scale the thing and carry out your analysis. Unfortunately, it does not happen so. Sometimes what happens, you will see this is going down like this, and this is a very realistic phenomena. What happens? This is called synchrotron cooling, because some of the higher energy particles will be lost from the energy, they will lose their energy, and then you will have this steepening. So here, while between this frequency, nu1, nu2, you were seeing this alpha, here you will be seeing some extra, some factor, you know, alpha 1. So then in this case, you cannot scale. Yeah. Synchrotron cooling is basically, you are, while you are accelerating these electrons to high energies, the electrons, because of this, the electrons which are having very high energy, they are losing their energy, and they are suddenly, you know, if there is no pumping of electron, then you will, cooling will in fact just suddenly, you will beyond a point, you will have no flux. Okay, but because there is an electron injection, rather than having this zero, you have this steepening by around 0.5 or so. So that is the synchrotron cooling. Not just that, you also have absorption by the same electrons which are producing synchrotron emission, and this is a direct function of wavelength. The longer the wavelength, higher the wavelength, more absorption it is. So this is an, I call it, we call it optically thick system. And this generally, if it is synchrotron self absorption, it generally goes as 2.5 in power law. Okay. So what does that mean? That at frequency is lower than this, when you are seeing the system, you are not seeing through the system, you are only seeing through the, you know, from the out, whatever is coming out from the outermost layer of the system. And it depends upon the frequency. Optically thick, optical depth is more than 1. I do not know what is inside this mic, whatever, I am seeing whatever is here. Okay, but here you are seeing through line of sight, you are seeing whatever is outside, and you are also seeing what is inside, because you can see through it. So then your speckle, you have actually 3 speckle indices, and you will see in gamma ray burst there are 3-4 speckle indices are there. So then it is not true, but in this case, so we will actually do that exercise. But the thing is, if you assume speckle index, if you find a speckle index, if it turns out to be same, then you can carry out some of this analysis, at least for a, you know, you, this is one instant of time. So if in a, on a one instant of time, if between different frequencies it is same, then it is fine. And these things are pretty important. This part will give you, because this is directly dependent upon the density, it will give you the information about the environment where this jet is interacting. This part is giving information about this particle acceleration. This part is directly proportional to the magnetic field. Okay, so this synchrotron cooling is directly proportional to, higher the magnetic field, faster the cooling is, it turns out. So if you do the physics of it, so you get the information, and this is in fact one of the ways where people find the magnetic field in some in galaxies, when they see synchrotron cooling, and then they, from that synchrotron cooling aging, this is also called synchrotron aging, they find the magnetic field of the system. Okay, so these are the different physics, but anyway, so we will get into the spectral index business and try to do the next exercise. So one thing is that strictly this works only for data observed exactly at the same epoch, but that may not be possible. That is not possible, because your telescope will work at a one frequency at a given time. So some, suppose like VLA, you do, say you have half an hour at this frequency, half an hour at that frequency, there is little bit difference in time, but similar to aperture synthesis, we are assuming that within, say, you know, few days or whatever time, it is not changing. And how do we decide that? Suppose this is synchrotron absorption, and since this is, you know, this is in the log scale, so this is in the log scale, so this is, because this is power law, this is a straight line, which means this is 1, this is 10, this is 100, and this is 1000. So suppose your transient source exploded, and so say for 1 to 10 days you may need to collect data, say every couple of days or so, which means if you are planning to have a speckle index, say on a day 2 data, you probably should not go within like say 0.2 or 0.3 day, you know, within the same day. And then between 1 and 10 days, after 10 days you can collect, you want to have a equal, you know, sample, nicely sampled data, 20 days, 40 days, you know. So then if you have data say around 20 day, then within plus minus 2 days also it's kind of near simultaneous data. Suppose your source is 3-4 months old or a year old and still emitting in radio band, then maybe within, you know, within a week or two also it is okay, you know 10-20 days. So this is the near simultaneous data, when we call it, is a relative term and depends upon at which epoch you are making the observation. Okay, and this also tells you, somebody was asking me, how do you decide the cadence of an observation for a transient? This is exactly the cadence you decide, right? Because the observation is in the log scale. So you have the observation, say when it just exploded, quick observation, then you can wait for a week or two. Once it is 1 year old, then you can observe maybe twice a year or something like that. So you decide the cadence so that this feels equally spaced in this scale, okay. And that's how we decide the near simultaneity of the data, and we find out the spectral index. This is the, here they're using S for the frequency. So now I think the next exercise is probably to decide the spectral index, and please determine the spectral index and tell me what do you get, what number do you get. And then in this exercise, I need to know the spectral index on 162 day, around 162 day. Okay, so that tells you, you can probably take the data within plus minus 10 days as near simultaneous data and use that data and determine the spectral index.
Curve fit is an awful way to find.
Sorry?
Curve fit is an awful way to find the spectral
index. Really?
Yeah,
you can just. That's true. Oh, David has done curve fit, right? Let me see. And error? Okay. But curve fit will be needed if you have multiple, you know, and you have 3D data. If you want to fit all the parameters at once, and then you. Okay, actually, I'm not sure, you know, both are equally good, right? You think you'll get better result with piecewise linear regressions? Because you don't have to worry about log scale or anything, and it's linear scale, and if you have to find only the spectral index, yeah, that's true. Okay, whatever spectral index you got, scale the data. What do you mean by scale the data? We are reducing the temporal variation from two parameters to one parameter. We are getting rid of the frequency dependence. Okay? And what are we assuming in that process? That frequency scaling is universal for this data set. This one spectral index will work for all the data, and we can scale. So choose any frequency which is your favorite, but the rule of thumb is that try to choose the one which has maximum data is at that frequency, because then you know that, you know, you have to scale less number of data points. It's close, pretty close. And what is your error bar? Well, error bar is quite important. What if your spectral index comes out to be 0.5 plus minus 0.9? Then you know that this one spectral index is not fitting all the data, right? It's not just for scaling, it is to know whether you are doing a reasonable thing or not, because not in all the cases you can scale the data. Then you can, yeah, if you see, it's difficult. You, there are multiple breaks, that's exactly I was showing. You have like, you have synchrotron self absorption break, you have this peak turnover break, then you have this cooling break. So there are already four sections. So generally we do not scale all the data. We generally try to keep the two parameters and retain that information. But here we are doing that. So now I want you to scale the data. Take your favorite frequency, bring every data to that frequency and plot the light curve, okay? And when you scale the fluxes, please also scale the RMS. Why I'm asking you to scale the RMS is because RMS is also, okay, here assuming your noise is the thermal noise. It is dependent upon the system temperature and the efficiency of the telescope at that frequency, and there are other parameters which is like number of baseline which remain same, but the system temperature and efficiency changes, and hence so the thermal noise is different at different frequencies. And since with so here is scaling the RMS is not really the right step, because the data is also with GMRT and with VLA, but I guess they have just scaled it, so we will just scale it. but yeah, you cannot just scale the RMS for between different telescopes, that is true. But I want to see the plot after scaling the data, and I would say you should choose say 3 gigahertz or something like that. And whosoever gets this kind of plot, please raise your hand. Scaling is basically, so as I said, your okay, so which means right, so that means your alpha was basically log of this divided by log of this. So which means if I want to keep all my data at 3 gigahertz, then I have to scale this based on this factor to this frequency. Yeah. And for the people who have been able to scale the data, something to think. So I have been talking about synchrotron emission as a non-thermal emission. Can you think of any other kind of mechanism which gives rise to non-thermal emission? Anything else? How does Bremsstrahlung go? Anybody who did not get this? Anybody to scale this, you need to get the spectral index. Anybody who got very much different than minus 0.6?
of you have an answer? How many of you are still working on it?
And how many of you are not working on anything? Yeah, please tell. But I need the error also, right? That's a pretty small error for a spectral index. Something doesn't look correct.
I get minus 0.56 plus and minus
0.07. So which is on 162 days. Okay, and how many data sets did you take? How many, like what is the near simultaneity did you take?
There are 9 data points.
9 data points.
Yeah.
Okay.
It looks like.
What are the range of in the time, like?
Oh, there's no time.
You took just that one day.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, because some people taken may have taken plus minus 2 days also or something, you know. Yes. Okay, and how many data points did you take, and what was the time range for which you considered the data to be same? So why are you two getting different answers?
I'm just giving it to more significant figures than the principal figures.
Oh, okay. Anybody who got stuck? If not, does everybody has the light curve which looks like this? Okay, whosoever got this light curve, please raise your hands. Okay, you show. Yeah, this light curve. Show me your light curve. You raised your hand, no? Just show me your light curve. Why don't you have those extra data points? Okay, but the light curve is for all the light curve means you have to do it for all the data, right? I know, but these you don't have these points, right? How come you don't? The data was same for everyone. See, the time you took, that was the estimation of the spectral index, but then for scaling you, we are creating the light curve. The data should be up to the same epoch. Is there an old data in that module? I don't know. Okay, so what does this light curve reveal? Because this light curve has turned out to be one of the most important light curve for this object. And do you know why? Well, it was always an afterglow. You are seeing the peak, yes? And no, actually in I couldn't hear you properly, but the peak had to come. It's a synchrotron emission, the peak has to come at some point. But this emission is, this shows, this is very crucial. Why? Because this part was revealing that it is more like a quasi-spherical emission, the way it was rising, if you read these papers. But then there is a peak, which is pretty sharp peak, and then there is a sharp decline. If a peak is very sharp, it's very difficult to get that kind of a peak from a quasi-spherical emission. It'll be more, you know, broader peak. So here it shows that peak is more like a peak from a narrow emission, a jet kind of thing. And then this is around minus 2, which a jet kind of geometry can produce. If it was a spherical geometry, you will have something around 0.75 or 0.8 or much flatter decline if you do the physics of this emission. So that's why this figure turned out to be very important, and these figures in this particular object, there was always a puzzle that when these neutron stars merged, there was this this ejecta which was called red kilonova, there was this polar emission which was called blue kilonova, which was and then there was this jet coming out of this, and whether this jet lost all its energy in this medium or whether this could come out of it. The fact that you saw the sharp peak and decline, that suggested that jet actually must have come out of it, and that's why you are seeing that kind of decline. So this, that's why that was very important in this particular case. So now that we know it was so important, you need to fit that light curve. That was the speckle index I was showing you, optically thick. This is light curve, 2.5 curve is within the frequencies.
Yes, this is the optical thickness is very high.
Yes, yes, but that is a light curve. This is a spectrum. Okay. So I want you to fit the data now and get me the three most important parameter, four most important parameter. At what time did it peak? What was the flux at that peak time? Okay. Before it reached to the peak, what was this point? And after the peak, how fast did it decline? And this is just a sharpness parameter. So, you know, that also will change because of that. So just carry out this fit on that data and tell me the parameters. What did you get? Yeah. See, the peak was because of the jet, because so what is in this case, the physical picture is that there was this polar ejecta and the jet was launched. But the jet, since when it was moving through this polar ejecta, this dynamic ejecta, it was losing its energy, and that created a kind of cocoon. And one was seeing the rate, this cocoon was moving with around 0.2, 0.3 kind of c kind of velocities. And this cocoon, when it was interacting with the medium, it was creating synchrotron emission. That's what we were seeing at early time, but around 150 days or so, or little before that, by the time the jet came out of the cocoon in say few seconds, couple of seconds itself. But since it was, the theory is this, it was little bit off axis, around 20 degrees, but as Lorentz factor started decreasing, the jet started to increase sideways. And in the radio band, it came in our line of sight. Okay, once it came in the line of sight, you started seeing the emission which was dominated by this jet, and now this all this physics at the late time is happening because of the jet. This is a light curve. It's not coming from the galaxy, because the flux has been taken only at the position of the gravitational wave, and we have enough resolution to not account for the to account for the galaxy emission and not count it in the flux. So it is not coming from the galaxy. If you were right, if you had the emission, if you had a bad resolution, see this, in this case the galaxy was only 5-6 arc seconds away. Suppose you were observing this say at very low frequency, where lambda is very high. So lambda by d is also the is very high, means resolution is poor. Then you will not know that this much flux is from the galaxy and this much from the event. But here I'm, whatever I'm showing you is a higher frequency data where you could resolve all the emission, and then you are seeing that. But actually in real life there are other ways to accommodate for this lack of good resolution. Suppose you have the data at that frequency before the gravitational wave event happened, and you have a very good image of the galaxy, and you see that in few images galaxy is not changing its flux, then you can actually, you can subtract that flux from the later images and get the. But here this is not the problem, this is all coming from the gravitational wave event. Yes. What are your numbers? Tell me.
So flux 3 gigahertz.
Yes.
Yeah.
No.
Well, the MCMC chain.
You don't have to do, no, no, MC, this, see, in this case, with this data, you don't need MCMC.
Oh,
okay.
MCMC.
No, why? I'll tell you. I thought that's the whole point. You use MCMC where MCMC is needed, right? Here, you, when you have a clear data, you don't need MCMC. You can simply fit the simple, you know, fitting with the, this function which I was showing you. You can just fit this broken power law and get the results. MCMC was needed for this case where they have taken some data out. Now the break is, the turnover is not very clear, and that's why I said that this exercise is pretty cool, because this, the, at least the solution is not there, but it should be like 2 minutes job. In fact, the interesting thing is to do it in a normal non-MCMC way, and then you can also try MCMC and see if the results are matching, how much MCMC is able to reproduce the robust fitting. If anybody is trying MCMC for this, just don't worry about that. Just do the, because here you really have enough parameters to fit the broken power law. Anybody with the results? Or if anyone is facing a problem, please let us know. Let one of the.
How many of you have tried fitting the broken power law directly? How many of you have tried fitting this equation directly? Okay, everyone should be trying to fit this equation. So those of you who do not know how to fit this, please raise your hands and tutors will come and help you.
That was the right question to ask. I didn't realize that. Yeah, but you should tell volunteers if you are facing any problem, right? That's what we are going to go in the next step. This is not fit in the solution, but it is a simple curve fit, or whichever, you know, way you want. Sorry? It's the same function, yeah, yeah. Please catch volunteers if you are not able to fit the data, this broken power law directly. And giving the initial conditions is not very difficult, because you have, say, T peak, these things, you can roughly have a sense of what to put, right? Yeah. Smoothness parameter you can choose, but larger the parameter is, sharper it will be, the peak or the broken power law. Smaller that parameter is, the more smooth this will be. Yeah, because it's just, you can see it from this formula, right? This, it's 1 over s. So you can start with something like, I don't know, 10 or something, see how it goes. In fact, many times there are not enough data points around the peak to even constrain the smoothness parameter, but here you have that kind of data that you may, you should be able to constrain the smoothness parameter also. And I am assuming you all are putting the scaled data in this, not, you are not feeding the initial data, right? Because we did this light curve was from the scale data.
Has anybody been able to fit this?
Okay. And anybody else?
How many of you are in the process of fitting this function? Everyone, awesome. How many of you think you will get it in 5 minutes? Good, good, go on.
Okay. Yes. Which alpha? There is no alpha in this fit, right? This is, I am putting delta 1, delta 2, which is because the time in. Alpha was the speckle index which you use to scale the data to bring it to some one frequency reference, and now you just have to fit and see the how with time how the power law goes before the break and after the break. There S will tell you the sharpness of the break, and then you have to have the peak flux and the peak time. And you have around 65 data sets, so you and you have only like 5 free parameters. So it's 150.66, okay. Okay. Let's just put 13. And what is that? 1 8. 1 1 8. Delta 1, delta 2. Okay. And S. Okay, so S is around little over 10. Yeah. Say around 15-ish or so. So this looks okay. This, I think in the paper this number is around minus 2 and this number is around 0.78 or something if I am not wrong. But what is your chi square? You may have done chi square minimization, right? You ran MCMC? Okay, what is 56.83 for around 60 degrees of freedom, right? Because you have 65 data points, you may have taken all almost one. Okay. Anyone else managed to get it? Okay, you must try because we have less than 5 minutes. You must try it at home. Okay, in the last few minutes, I am just going to say that there is another way of doing this which is called MCMC, and I am sure many of you may not have done it, but it's there in the notebook. You can try. It's just that it, in this case, for example, there is this data is not there and there is more ambiguity, and you can use this technique. And basically what happens in MCMC are two things: Markov chain, Monte Carlo method. So Markov chain is basically, if I have to give you an example, based on the present information you predict the future information, basically in the most simplest of the term. For example, what are the example? For example, suppose you have to find like how much will be the queue on the, say, Jet Airways counter. You have the information that, you know, on the basis of present you can make some future prediction, or, you know, exchange rate of currencies. So you do not have the information, but based on less than ideal information you are trying to predict a distribution. So that is called Markov chain, and Monte Carlo is basically generation of random numbers but in a constraint way. It's like a random walk problem. Okay, so in Python there is a program called mkey program, and I think that program is so this mkey software is I think already there in the Docker, and I suggest that you try to run the same thing, the same data with MCMC method, and try to see what results you will get. Okay, so you have to set the, you know, you have to define your a prior likelihood and probability, and prior, right, like you, when you look at the light curve, you know that your T peak is between, say, day 50 to day 250 or something. Your S is you know, sharpness parameter, you can set something. Delta 1 is positive, you know those. So some of the a priori you can set, and then you can, so these things are going to take actually few minutes to run each of these things, but you can start with a small number of, say, you know, you can take just 100 iterations to start with and see how fast it runs on your laptop, and then you can try to increase the iterations and try to run. And then I would suggest that, and see, this is the chain loss, and you see that within, you know, that how your numbers are converging. So these are, they've taken different parameters: peak flux, T peak, delta 1, delta 2, and, you know, log S, which is basically your sharpness parameter. And then you can basically see here, this is the plot, and what you did with the direct power law, you can see with this how your results compare with MCFC method versus the direct broken power law fitting. Actually, this, when this was done and this paper was published by Dobie et al, these data did not exist, and they wanted to predict whether the jet break actually happened or not happened, because that was very important at that time to know. So that's why this, because in this data it is not that clear, that because you may be able to fit a straight line also, and that's why the MCMC was done. And in fact, in this MCMC, if you go down, you will also see that they have fit only for single power law without putting a break in it, and the results are not too crazy. Okay, the results are not too crazy, but you can do some tests like F test and some you know, some statistical analysis, and try to find out that which of the two models is preferred. So I suggest that you read about some basic information about MCMC, and the steps are there, and install the MK package in your, it's freely available package, and you install the software from this. This is the MK website. And then you try to run it yourself and try to fit different functions and see whether, you know, what kind of results you get. And this is an exercise to do at home, and you can learn, you know, a little more about MCMC, how to proceed and how to do the fittings, how to create these, you know, how to create these. Basically it's literally like a random walk problem, that it based on the present situation, once I'm here I can either go this way or this way. then where I was in the past does not matter now. It's only at the basis of my present information I am doing the next. So my next step depends upon my present situation. So that kind of a, you know, that is the concept of philosophy behind it. So I think I would want you to do that. And it's already 5:01 and Ashish has to say something. So maybe I'll just ask Ashish to take over and this session ends now, but I do want you to take this MCMC part and do it at home.
Let's thank Poonam.
Okay, remember what I said earlier that for machine learning we need a lot of data. So this is an exercise which I am hoping you can help me with some data.
So if you go to this URL, I'll explain what it is that we want from there. Let me know once you are there. So some of you may need to create a Zooniverse login to go there. So note this down somewhere anyway, because if you cannot do it now, what I really want you to do is do it maybe tonight. Right, so note the URL. You may need to create a Zooniverse login. So I'm going to go and show the quick couple slides with Zooniverse. And so this is what the public survey is. And what we created here, once you get started, is that you see a task like this. Okay, so what we have here are three images. This is the science image, this is the reference image, this is the difference image. I suppose you heard a little bit about that during some talk. So you subtract the reference from science and get difference, or the other way around, and that is what is decided by this. True means that it is science minus reference. If this is a false, then it will be reference minus science. And this is the pan-STARRS image, corresponding image. There is some metadata, class star, obviously if it is a star or not, elongation, how elongated the image would be, Mach PSF, how bright it is, FWHM, how bad the PSF was. And this is a light curve. Normally G and R, both of them are shown. This is MSIP data. So we created this fantastic thing to be put out for public. There was a nice beta review from Zooniverse, and people, some of them said it's too difficult, some of them said it's too easy, but we worked a bit more on that. And right at the end, what we were told that, no, this is too complicated for most people. They won't understand this. So what you should do is that you should just leave these three images. Take the pan-STARRS image out, take the light curve out, take the metadata out, and show it to people. Now, for astronomers, that's not really true, right? The more data you have, the better decisions you can make. So what I would like you to do, not the common people, but you to do, because you have been looking at all these astronomy things, is that over the next couple of days, if you could do 100 classifications each, that'll be fantastic. And so what we have is that we have a field guide here, we have a tutorial. There are four classes that we have. So a transient is something that may not have been there before, and now it is there, so you see it. Whereas a variable is something that would have been there before too. A bad subtraction is a genuine astronomical object, but you will see that the subtraction was bad. So you, and there are examples of all that in the field guide as well as in tutorial. An artifact is a non-astronomical object, and if you're not sure, you can simply skip. So I'll quickly show a little bit from the field guide how it looks. There's a lot of things there. And similarly, in the tutorial, you have got a few things. So you can look at either of those two, and you have all the details. So we won't go any further. You don't have to do it now. You have the URL. You may have to create a Zooniverse login. And 100 classifications each, that will give us a few thousand. That will be really useful. And again, mainly because with the Zooniverse crowd, we may not be able to show them all these things. And that's all that I wanted to say.
So that brings us to the close of our meeting and of our winter school. And this is actually the time to thank everyone who has really worked very hard to make this possible. And the list, of course, begins with all of our wonderful volunteers. You have seen all of them as tutors, but they have been working behind the scene for well over a month now just to make sure everything happens. So we have Shubham, Harsh, Devita. Could you stand up, all of you, please? Yeah. So we have Shubham, Harsh, Devita, Gaurav, Viraj, Akash, Jinay, Yashvi, Tanaza, Smarnika, and then of course we had our, these are all currently students at IIT Bombay, and they were very nicely supported by two of our former students, Pavan and Atharva.
So these are all, this is the team that has really been working hard to make sure that, starting right from shortlisting applications, selection and everything. And along with this team, we also have Vijay and Varsha. So this is the IIT Bombay team that has really made the winter school possible. And I request all of you to please give them a big round of applause. Wait a minute, we have one addition coming in. And of course, in addition to this team, we have also had enormous support from the entire growth community. In particular, Igor has worked very, very hard to make sure that the modules were all available and that and along with him, all the module developers and people who have taken the tutorials, who have taken the lectures here, you have all seen them, you have all heard them over the last 3 days. So thank you all very much. The growth collaboration itself, this winter school was conducted by Growth India, where the PIs are GC Anupama at IIA and myself. And we would like to thank the DST SERB and IUSSTF for supporting the Growth India endeavor. And in addition to that, we also would like to thank the International Growth Collaboration for giving us the chance to host this year. And I'm going to single out Mansi for thanking as the PI of the Growth Collaboration. And in addition, we would also like to thank the various funding agencies, include NSF around the world, which have made this amazing, amazing collaboration possible. And of course, we would not have been able to do all of this without your enthusiastic support and your enthusiastic participation. There's one last thing we want you to do before you all head off, which is we have feedback forms for all of you to fill. But and then, of course, we have to hand out the certificates that we want that for all of you for participation. So let's all thank everyone. And of course, Anupama again, we have to thank Anupama for all her support and all the extended support that she has also given as director of the Indian Astronomical Observatory. And that is how all the remote observing sessions were possible. So thank you all. And we close the session here.